वेलकम टू स्टेज क्राफ्ट हायर्स अकेडमी. एज यू ऑल नो वी हैव स्टार्टेड अ न्यू इनिशिएटिव कॉल द डेली करंट अफेयर्स डिस्कशन एंड यू गेट द पीडीएफ ऑफ दिस वीडियो ऑन द स्टेज क्राफ्ट्स टेलीग्राम चैनल स्टेज क्राफ्ट्स वेबसाइट एज वेल एज इन द डिस्क्रिप्शन बॉक्स ऑफ दिस वीडियो. सो लेट्स गेट स्टार्टेड विद द करंट अफेयर्स. आवर फर्स्ट टॉपिक ऑफ डिस्कशन इज एंटी हेल गन. सो दिस गन इज बेसिकली अ मशीन दैट जनरेट्स शॉक वेव्स टू डिस्टर्ब द ग्रोथ ऑफ हेल स्टोन्स इन द क्लाउड. So what hails are? So hail is a type of precipitation or water in the atmosphere. So what basically happens is when the drops of water freezes together in the upper regions of the thunderstorm, where thunderstorm clouds, where it is very cold, they formed like a chunks of ice, as you can see in this image. So these chunks of ice are called hailstones. So what this gun basically does is it generates shock waves to disrupt the growth of these hailstones. And this gun is developed indigenously by IIT Bombay. And the gun comprises of a tall fixed structure like an inverter tower. And when the gun is fired by, this gun is actually fired by feeding an explosive mixture of acetylene gas and air. So this releases a shock wave. And this shock wave stops the water droplets in the cloud from turning into hailstones. And they simply fall as raindrops. So this is in news because hail is a big issue in Himachal Pradesh, and every summer from March to May, frequent hailstorms in the fruit growing areas of Himachal destroy apples, pears and other crops, causing massive loss to the farmers. And also in some hail prone areas, the entire apple crop in an orchard may sometimes get destroyed during such storms. Next we'll talk about the Lamu Port. So Lamu Port is in Kenya. Note, it is in Kenya. So whenever a port or a city of particular country comes in news, it's important to note where that port or the city is. So in this case, Lamu Port is in Kenya. And it is Kenya's second deep water port after Mombasa. And this port is a part of the Lamu Port South-Southern Ethiopia Transport Corridor. Next, we'll see the location of Kenya and the bordering countries. So it is bordered by Somalia, Ethiopia, Sudan, Uganda and Tanzania. Also here you can see in the map that Lamu, it's in the southeastern region of Kenya. And also you can see Lake Victoria. So Lake Victoria is a very important lake of Africa and it is surrounded by Uganda, Kenya and Tanzania. Note, it is Lake Victoria is surrounded by Uganda, Kenya and Tanzania. Next, we'll discuss about the Operation Pangaea 14. So, a record number of fake online pharmacies have been shut down under the Operation Pangaea, targeting the sale of counterfeit and illicit medicines and medicinal products. So, this operation was conducted by Interpol. So, basically, this operation is to close down all the to find out the fake online pharmacies which are involved in the sale of counterfeit or illicit medicines or medical products. So if there's a question in exam, you know, asking what Operation Pangaea is related to, so it is basically to, you know, find out the pharmacies who are involved in the sale of counterfeit and illicit medicines. Next, we'll discuss about World Energy Investment Report 2021. So, this report is released by International Energy Agency. The report, it analyzes how energy investment flows are recovering from the shock of COVID-19 pandemic. And it includes a full year outlook estimates. Talking about the key findings, so the global energy investment is set to recover by nearly 10% in 2021. Also, the global power sector, which has seen a flat investment in 2020, is set to receive highest ever funding, which is up to 5% more than $820 billion. And also, it's good to note that the renewables are forecasted to amount around 70% of the total funding. So bigger investment is done, or bigger investment is planned to be done on renewables. Also, technologies like carbon capture and storage are yet to attain commercial success, द इन्वेस्टमेंट इन ऑयल इज एक्सपेक्टेड टू ग्रो बाय अबाउट 10%. Now we'll see net zero plan. So I've also discussed about net zero in my previous video. So it is basically balancing the amount of emissions that has been produced to the amount of emission that has been absorbed. So that there's no extra emission left in the atmosphere. So in the commitment to net zero plan is also gaining momentum, but its transition to actual vision, it's not possible. And also, next we'll talk about International Energy Agency. So it is an autonomous intergovernmental organization which was established in 1974. It focuses on energy policies which include economic development, energy security and environmental protection. So these policies are known as the three E's of IEA. Next, India became an associate member of IEA in 2017, but it was in engagement with IEA long before. And also recently, India has inked a strategic partnership agreement with IEA to strengthen the cooperation in global energy security, stability and sustainability. So other reports of IEA include World Energy Investment Report, World Energy Outlook Report and Global Energy Review. Next, we'll talk about bluefin masseer. So recently, IUCN has moved the bluefin masseer from the endangered to the least concerned status on its red list. And this masseer belongs to the genus Tor. This bluefin masseer or Tor kundri, the other name of this masseer, it is one of the subspecies of masseer and the IUCN status has now changed to least concern. It is a silvery bluish colored fish with blood red fins. And it is important to know that it is in an indicator species. So this masseer, it's very sensitive to the dissolved oxygen level, to water temperature and to sudden climate changes. It also cannot bear pollution. So it acts as an indicator of the ecosystem's health. It basically means that if there is an increased number of bluefin masseer in a water body, it shows that the environment in the water body is clean and pure. Also, it has the required level of oxygen. Next, the fish actually feeds on plants, fruits, insects, shrimps, and they are also predatory and they prey on smaller masseers. They are talking about the habitat. They are found in the Mula Mutha River, which is in Pune, and it is also in the part of the Krishna River basin. It is also found in other rivers of the Deccan Plateau. And the species is migratory and moves upstream during the rains. Talking about the conservation initiative by Tata Power, the Tata Power was involved in conservation of the bluefin and the golden masseer for around 50 years in an artificial lake which is in Lonavala, Maharashtra. So the company has created a huge lake by damming the Indriani River, and it is at this artificial lake the bluefin and the golden species of masseer congregate, and once the eggs hatch they remain in the lake for 4 to 6 months and they are then handed over to the various fisheries department. Next we'll talk about Project 75i. So the Defence Acquisition Council, which is headed by the Defence Minister, has approved the request for proposal for the construction of 6 conventional submarines under Project 75i. So talking about the project, it was approved in 2007 and is a part of the Indian Navy's 30-year plan for indigenous submarine constructions. So these 6 submarines under the Project 75i will be built under the strategic partnership model. We'll further discuss what the strategic partnership model is. So talking about the project, it is estimated cost is 43,000 crores. And its feature include, and one of the most important feature is that it is equipped with air independent propulsion system. So this system actually enables the vessels to stay underwater for a longer period, and also it enhances their combat facilities, that is the fighting capabilities. And this the first submarine built under this project is likely to be delivered by 2030, and the two Indian companies which have been shortlisted as the strategic partners are Mazagon Dock Shipbuilder Limited and Larsen & Toubro. Also foreign manufacturers are also selected for the project. And the talking about the significance, it is the first project to be approved under strategic partnership model, and it would be one of the largest Make in India projects. It will create an industrial ecosystem for submarine constructions in India. Also, it will reduce the current dependence on the imports and gradually ensure greater self-reliance, a step towards Atmanirbhar Bharat. Next, we'll talk about 30-year submarine plan. So the Cabinet Committee on Security in June 1999 had approved a 30-year submarine building plan, which included construction of 24 conventional submarines indigenously by 2030. So this P-75I has succeeded the P-75, which under which six diesel electric attack submarines of Kalvari class based on the Scorpion class was built at Mazagon Dock Limited. And of the sixth, the third submarine, that is INS Karanj, was recently commissioned in March 2021. And of the total 24 submarines to be built in India, six will be nuclear powered. And India currently has only one nuclear submarine, that is INS Arihant. And the INS Arighat, also a nuclear powered ballistic missile submarine, is to be commissioned soon. So talking about the strategic partnership model, it is a part of the defense procurement procedure. It focuses on indigenous manufacturing of major defense platforms by the Indian strategic partners. So these partners will also collaborate with foreign original equipment manufacturers to set up production facilities in the country itself. Next, we'll talk about black carbon. So the World Bank has released a report titled "The Glaciers of the Himalayas, Climate Change, Black Carbon, and Regional Resilience." So talking about the Himalayan Karakoram and Hindu Kush mountain region, it consists of almost 55,000 glaciers, and they store more fresh water than any other region outside the North and South Poles. Also, their ice reserves feed into three major river basins in the South Asia, that is the Indus, the Ganges, and the Brahmaputra. And these rivers are home to 750 million people. Next, we'll talk about black carbon. So it's a greenhouse gas, and it is a short-lived climate pollutant, and it is the second largest contributor to warming after carbon dioxide. And it absorbs solar energy and warms the atmosphere. So basically, when this falls to the earth with precipitation, it darkens the surface of the snow or the ice on which it falls, and thus reduces the albedo. So this albedo is a term in geography. It refers to the reflecting power of a surface. And thus this black carbon reduces the albedo and also warms the snow, which results in faster glacier melting. However, this unlike other greenhouse gases, the black carbon is short-lived. It is quickly washed out and can be eliminated from the atmosphere if the emission stops. The sources of black carbon in the region include industry, primarily brick kilns, and residential burning of solid fuel. That amounts to around together amounts to around 45 to 66% of the total black carbon emissions. And then the next source is on-road diesel fuels, which is around 7 to 18%. And the last one is the open burning, which is less than 3% in all seasons. So the key findings include that the black carbon deposit, which is produced by human activity, actually accelerate the pace of glacier and snow melting in the Himalayan region. And the rate of retreat of these glaciers is estimated to be around 0.3 meters per year to 1 meter per year. So this rate of retreat basically means the amount of glaciers that has been melting is greater than the amount of snow that has been accumulating. Also, the black carbon adds to the impact of climate change, and the deposit of black carbon acts in two ways, to pace the glacier melt. First, it decreases the surface reflectance of the sunlight, that is, it reduces the albedo, and then it raises the rises the air temperature. So all for today guys, if you like the video, please like, share and subscribe. Thank you.